My name is Mike Rodriguez, and I work with the Zig Ziglar Corporation here in Dallas. I'm very proud to be a part of the Zig Ziglar Corporation. I've followed Zig Ziglar for the last 20 years. In fact, Zig Ziglar has had a very profound effect on my life. Any of you who are familiar with Zig Ziglar knows that the teachings of Zig Ziglar are timeless. And not only are they timeless, but they're proven as well. So I've been tasked with a very special mission, and that is I'm one of several people in the world who have been certified to carry on Zig Ziglar's legacy. So I'm not Zig Ziglar, and I don't claim to be Zig Ziglar, but I can tell you this. I know his stuff. He's touched my heart and transformed my life, and I am a part of their family, and I have family here to validate that. So the first thing I want to do is thank all of you for investing in yourself to come out today. You know, any time that you want to make a change in your life, the first thing to do is to make a decision. Anytime you're challenged with any decision in your life, the first thing starts with a decision. That's the piece that throws most of us off. And so today, we're going to talk about some of the cool things that are going to help you to make those decisions to become whoever it is that you want to be. So here's a question that I want to ask you. By show of hands, how many of you can think of something that you can do over the next 2 weeks that can make your life better? By show of hands. Now, if you look around the room, you'll see that's everybody in here. Now, my next question to you is this. How many of you can think of something you can do the next 2 weeks that can make your life worse? By show of hands. Now, here's the cool thing about that. You've just told yourself that you have the power to control your life. See, and this is where we get mixed up as people, is we somehow believe that there's some outside circumstance or some outside situation that's indirectly in control of our life. And what you need to understand that as long as you are breathing, you have a life and you have value. And you, most importantly, are in control of that life. Now, Joe Sabat tells us that you don't have to be great to start, but you must start in order to be great. This is the part that throws everybody off. Well, Mike, I have goals, and I have dreams, and I have plans, and there's things I want to do, but in the middle, somehow life happens to us, and I just never really get started. And so it's important for you to figure out what your dreams are, and we're going to show you how to turn those dreams into goals. We're going to give you a plan that's going to allow you to incorporate, to follow, to become the person you want to be, to build the best you. Zig Ziglar taught us that success and happiness are not matters of chance, but they're matters of choice. And I'm going to tell you what that means, is that you have the power, you have the choice to choose if you're going to be happy. So what happens to us is as we're going along life, and things happen to us, situations, you go, well, Mike, you don't understand what happened to me. I deserve the right to feel this way. And we carry around anger and resentment and disappointment and depression like it's a badge of courage. And then we hold ourselves in that spot. There's no nobility in that. You can choose to be happy. And what I challenge each of you today is to figure out what makes you happy. And if you don't know, we're going to figure that out as we go through here. And tap into your happiness. Tap into what makes you happy. Zig Ziglar left a lot of great things with us. Part of the legacy that he left with us was this process on how to build the best you. Now, if you look at this diagram here, there's a couple things that stand out. Number one, you'll see that in order to build the best you, you have to have a foundation. We're going to talk about the foundation of what's required in order for you to become the person that you truly want to be. The second thing we're going to talk about are these steps in order to get there, and this is what I was referencing earlier. So as you go each step, you're going to see that tomorrow, the things we want tomorrow are available for us. They are available for us, and you can make them happen. You see, happiness is not set aside for certain people. You deserve to be happy, and you can be happy, and the choice is yours. You just have to believe it. You have to understand that as long as that breath is inside you, your life has value. Now, I will tell you this. The one thing that Zig Ziglar taught us, to me, that was really a big foundational element is hope. Without hope, nothing really matters. The student who doesn't believe in hope is not going to study. If you don't believe that you're going to be successful in your job, you won't. If you don't believe your relationship is going to make it, it's already destined to fail. So the great thing is this, folks. When thousands of people were asked what they want, this is what they want. And I'm sure you want these same things too. You know, when I first started with Zig Ziglar Corporation, I had a friend of mine tell me, "You're working with Zig Ziglar now? Oh man, you've got to be happy all the time." Think about this, though. How many of us have that same mindset? We have to start with us first. Why is it important to start with us? Well, I'm going to tell you why. Because as you're going through life each day, life is going to happen to you. And it's not what happens to you that matters. It's how you respond to what happens to you. This is another one Zig tells us. You are where you are and what you are based on what's gone into your mind. But you can change where you are. You can change what you are by changing what goes into your mind. Write a victory list. When you have a success, I don't care how small it is, you write it down. Each day when something good you do, write it down. And I'm going to tell you why. Because when you have that tough day, when you have that challenging day, when things aren't going the way you expect them to go, guess what you're going to do? You're going to open up that victory list. And you're going to take a look at all of the positive things that are going on in your life. So instead of saying, "My life's a mess and this isn't going right," and reinforcing that negative behavior and those negative thoughts, you can now say, "Wait a minute. I'm not happy with the way things are turning out right now, but that's okay. Because I remember when I got that award at work. And I remember the day that I came home and did something for my family. And I remember that I started working out. And I remember that I did this. And I remember that I did this. And what do you think will happen?" It's the good stuff that you're putting inside. And you start feeding yourself the positive stuff. And again, what's the alternative? You're going to be drawn back to that negativity. That negativity wants you to stay in that certain place. You stay right here. But don't go, "I don't like you doing things to improve." You stay right here. And don't you move, because you can't do that anyways. You haven't done it before. One time you did do it and you failed. You remember that? Failure's okay. We're going to get to that in a minute. The definition of try is this. It's non-committal. Try means that I'm going to do it, but if things get too tough, I have an exit. If things get too hard, or it's not working out, or something else comes along, I have an exit. So when you communicate with people or you have a goal and somebody goes, "Let's do this." And you go, "Well, I'll try." Here's what I hear. "I'm not really committed. And when things get too tough, I have an out." Do you see how that works? So by eliminating the word try and learning to communicate in positives, by default, you up your level of commitment. By default, you up your level of commitment. Because if you ask me to do something and I say, "I'm in," two things have happened. Number one, there's an expectation from you about me. And now that you have an expectation and I know the expectation, what are the chances that I'm going to give 60% versus 100%? I have to. My brain is now scrambling going, "Oh my goodness, what did you get us into? Now we can't back out. You didn't give us the option. What if we fail?" And this is what we do with our friends. "I'm going to start a business." "Wouldn't do it." "Why not?" "What if you fail?" "Ooh, that's a good point." "I'm going to start working out." "What if you don't accomplish your goals?" "I heard you won't lose any weight." Better not do that. You see, the thing is when you're putting yourself in a situation to become better, you're going to find that other people, some people, are going to discourage you. Has anybody encountered that? Zig called those SNIOPs. SNIOP, an S-N-I-O-P. You're susceptible to the negative influence of other people. How many of us have ever been susceptible to the negative influence of other people? I have. Well, you get one person in. What if you get two? Well, if two people tell me I can't do it, I probably can't. Hey, there's a position that's open up at work. You ought to go for it. Well, I'll try. While you try, I'm going to do it. Now, what are you thinking of me? Right? Do you guys see that? What are you thinking of me? If you're up for a job interview and you go, hey, I'm gonna try out for that job, and I go, I'm gonna get that job, that's my job. Your confidence level just went, doo. And I haven't done one thing, but just shared words with you. But how you've elected to choose those words has changed your attitude, and it's gonna affect your action. And do you think you're gonna give 100% to get that job? And while I know that I said, I'm gonna do that job, what are the chances I'm gonna give 100%? Do you see the impact of that? Now I'm gonna teach you guys that the word try actually does not exist. When people get married, nobody ever goes up to the altar and says, do you take this person to be your awful or wedded wife? And they go, I'll try! Because you would go, what? You're not gonna commit to me? Come on, we know it there. And marriage is probably one of the best examples because there's challenges every day in marriage. There's a big difference between a goal and a dream. How many of you have dreams? So everybody has dreams, and we think about our dreams on a daily basis. Now, there's a big difference between a dream and a goal. We're going to get into what makes a dream different from a goal. So ever since the time we were little, we think about things that we want in life. And then as we progress in life, life starts to happen to us. And as life starts to happen to us, our dreams start to suppress. And then sometimes some event will happen that will cause us to refocus on our dreams. And sometimes that pain is strong enough where it can prompt us to action. You must have goals. If you don't have goals, then your dream will always remain a dream. Goals are important. There was a French entomologist named Jean-Henri Fabre, and he conducted an experiment with the processionary caterpillars. They were called the processionary caterpillars because they follow each other if you line them up in procession. Pretty simple enough, right? So here was the experiment that he did. He took these caterpillars and he took a flower pot. So think of a round flower pot about this big. And he lined these caterpillars up back to back, all of the way around. They walked around the flower pot in a continuous circle every day. They walked. They went around. And they went around. And after 7 days, they started dying. Now here's the thing. Less than 3 inches away, there were pine needles, which is the preferred food of the processionary caterpillar. You see, all of these caterpillars died with food less than 3 inches away because they confused activity with accomplishment. I'm doing something. I don't know where we're going. This looks familiar. I don't know where I'm going. This looks familiar. I wake up every morning. See you later. I'm at work. See you later. Good night. We have the same challenge. Sometimes we confuse activity with accomplishment. Just because I go to work every day does not mean I'm accomplishing anything. And if I went to work yesterday and I'm going to go to work tomorrow, that means I'm 2 days older and not any wiser. So this experiment concluded that if you don't have a focus, you become a wandering generality. There's a lot of folks out there that are wandering generalities. I get up every morning and I have a routine because that's the routine I did before. And I get up today and I do the routine because that's the routine I did yesterday. How many of you have a routine in the morning? Does your routine change very often? That's good. For the rest of us, we pretty much have the same routine. And usually the only thing that will cause that routine to change is if we experience some kind of pain. For example, if I start becoming late to work more often, I may change my routine, right? So Zig tells the story of a guy that he said, sir, when did you start working here? And he says, when they told me they were going to fire me. Well, we do the same thing. We get up every morning to follow the same routine, And then we get to work and we do the same routine. We did the yesterday, we're going to do it today. And then we get home, we walk in, how was work? It was good. How was your work? Good. What's for dinner? When are we going to bed? And it's the same routine. Ben Hogan was a golfing legend. Is anybody familiar with Ben Hogan? He was a golfing legend. He didn't just walk out and play golf one day and get better and better and then all of a sudden start playing in PGA tournaments. He practiced and practiced and practiced to get better. And he had a goal to be in a PGA tournament. Neil Armstrong, same thing, he's just a man, just like you. A woman, just like you. But they had a plan, and they followed that plan. Now, the cool thing about Ben Hogan that I uncovered that I think is really interesting is this. And it's a great story, and it's not just a story or a testament to goals, but it's a testament to the desire to follow your goals. And it really buttons up everything that we've talked to you about failure as an event, not a person. And you truly only fail when you stop completely. On February 2nd, 1949, Ben Hogan was with his lovely wife, Valerie, and they're driving down the road. Now, they didn't plan on getting into an automobile accident. Nobody ever plans for tragedies. They just happen. But right about the time as they're going through the road, a Greyhound bus, bam, right in the front of them. They had a head-on collision with a Greyhound bus. Ben, who sensed the bus coming, leaped over to cover his wife, Valerie, to save her life. Not knowing by that sheer act of selfishness, he saved his own life. Because on the impact, the steering wheel went through the driver's seat. Ben Hogan was spared that day. He fractured his collarbone, his hips, his ankles, and he was put in the hospital. Now, a doctor visited him while he was in the hospital. The doctor told him this, "Mr. Hogan, I have some bad news for you. Not only will you never walk again, but you're never going to play golf again either." So there's Ben Hogan, and he's laying in this hospital bed. And you have another man who's telling you what your fate is. Now, see, what this doctor didn't understand was that Ben Hogan had goals. Ben Hogan had a goal. He had a dream that he turned into a goal. Ben Hogan started working on himself. And to get better, he started walking. And every day he would walk. And 59 days later, he left the hospital. In November of the same year, 9 months later, he started playing golf again. The very next year, he was back in the PGA. Now, do you think Ben Hogan was laying in bed when the doctor said that? And he goes, "Well, that's bad news. Not sure what I'm going to do now." Do you think Ben Hogan said, "Well, Doc, I'm going to try to get better. I'll see what happens. I mean, if what you're telling me is true, you've decided my fate. I better just lay here." See, he didn't accept the words of another man. Because his goal was bigger than this man who was telling him. Your goals and your dreams are bigger than other people who are telling you you can't do it. And if you're telling yourself you can't do it, you got to change. Zig calls that stinking thinking. And you got to do a checkup from the neck up. Get rid of that stinking thinking. There's enough people out there who are going to tell you you can't do stuff. Don't do that to yourself. So I want to start off this segment by telling you a story. There's a little boy, and this little boy lives way out in the country, and his family doesn't really have a lot of money, and they live in a trailer up on the side of a hill, and that hill overlooks a field that's not used very often. But one day, a circus is coming to town, and he catches wind of it. And so he goes to his mom and says, "Mama, is it okay if I sit up here and watch the circus when they come and set up?" And she says, "Well, son, you can do that, but just don't go down there and get in the way." He said, "That's great." So as the circus comes into town and all the carts and all the trains start coming and they start circling and unloading, he sits down and he watches. The thing that stands out to him is there's a big cart that comes up, big part of the train, and the door pops open. And the magnificent elephants come out. This little boy has never seen an elephant before, and he's amazed at how big these elephants are. So he decides, I'm going to watch these elephants today. That's what I have my eye on. So he watches the elephants as they go slowly and majestically, and they pick up giant bars of steel and giant wooden poles and canvas. And all day, with grace, he watches them, their beauty, their size, and how they just start picking up things and carrying them. At the end of the day, one of the trainers grabs one of the largest elephants, and he leads him over, and he wraps a small rope around his leg, and he ties it. And he takes the other end of that rope and he puts it on a little wooden peg. And he proceeds to hammer that little peg into the ground. At the sight of this, the little boy just can't believe it. He told his mom he wouldn't get involved, but he runs down the hill. And he runs up to the trainer. And he says, sir, I've got to talk to you. The trainer says, son, what's the problem? He said, well, sir, I've been here all day and I've been overseeing what you've been doing today. And I've been watching these elephants. And I don't know if you know or not, but these elephants are majestic. And he says, yes, they are. He said, they're also very strong. He said, yes, they are. He said, well, you just put a little rope around his leg and put it on a little stick and put it in the ground. You know, he could break free of that. And the trainer said, yeah, he could. He thought he could. But you see, son, ever since he was a baby elephant, we put that rope around his leg. And we put it on that peg. And we pounded it in the ground. And he would pull. And he would pull. And he couldn't break free. So he's grown up believing that he cannot break free from that rope tied to that little peg. The boy was dumbfounded, and he went home. So my question to you is this. What limitations have you put on yourself? What boundaries have you grown up believing that you can't do? What limitations have you put on yourself? You see, from the time we're born to the time we grow up, we're either telling ourselves we can't do something, or somebody else is telling us you can't do that. And to a certain extent, we start to believe this, and it starts to become a part of who we are. And regardless of how magnificent and grandiose we are inside, we still limit our belief and our potential to how we view ourselves. Would you let somebody come to your house, knock on your door, walk into your living room, and empty a bag of trash into your living room? How many would let somebody do that? In fact, probably the first thing you would say is, what are you doing at my doorstep with your trash, my friend? If they decided to walk in your house, you'd say, whoa, slow down. What are your plans? And you see how protective we are of that? Here's my question to you. Why aren't you as protective of your mind? Because we go to work and we let people tell us that this job is no good, or I can't do this, or you can't do this, or you're not going to believe what happened over to me, and you can't believe I didn't get a raise, and guess what happened to me out in the parking lot? They're dumping trash in your mind. And sometimes we get a part of that and we say things like, well, tell me more. Well, that's just horrible. Well, you know what? I had that happen to me too. Let's go get some coffee and baste in this. How is your attitude? You have to work at your attitude every day. And for some reason, we feel comfortable focusing on negativity and other things. It's almost like a comfort level. We've conditioned ourselves to think. Success can be defined with three words, and then some. Go up to your boss today, not tomorrow. Call your boss today, not tomorrow. Hey, listen, what can I do to do a little bit more around here to help out? That's all you say. How many of you think you'd get a positive response from that? By show of hands? You see, I ask the easy questions like Tom, right? Because if you ask that, first of all, they're going to be startled and say, who is this again?
Go ahead and
ask. Tom, what can I do? Now he's going to hold me accountable. Mike, is there something you want to ask me? But here's what I'm going to end with on work. And like I said, I'm not going to spend a lot of time, but this is what it boils down to. When we do more than we are paid to do, eventually we'll be paid more for what we do. Think about this. If you want a raise, go earn it. You want a promotion? Educate yourself. Do a little bit more. And here's the thing, you don't have to do a lot. Just a little bit more. And each day you do a little bit more, and you become a little bit better, and you do a little bit more, and you become a little bit better. And the effects and the impact on your work will be tremendous. And you don't have to tell anybody about it, because everybody will notice it. And that's when people say, what are you doing? And by default, you've become a leader. How great is that? Is anybody familiar with the Chinese bamboo tree? So the Chinese bamboo tree is a very unique plant. It's very unique because of the fact of how it grows. Now, I'm not a gardener by choice, but but I've had the opportunity to do a little research on this, and this is what I've learned about the Chinese bamboo tree. Is that an individual who decides to grow a Chinese bamboo tree has to understand this, that the Chinese bamboo tree takes 5 years to grow. Now, during that 5 years, when you put a seed in the ground, you've got to take care of it, and you've got to water it, and you've got to nurture it. And every day, you've got to go back, and you've got to feed it, and you've got to water it, and you've got to nurture it. And though you cannot see anything above the ground, underneath the ground, amazing thing is happening. The roots to the Chinese bamboo tree have started to grow. This is the point where you have friends come up, and the Chinese bamboo tree is just like dreams. Because when you work on a dream, sometimes you don't see it yet. But the roots are growing. And each day you nurture your dreams, and you water your dreams, and you put positive things into your dreams. But just like a Chinese bamboo tree, you know there are people who walk up and say, what you doing? I'm growing a Chinese bamboo tree. Really? It's been 2 years now. I don't see anything. What about your goals? I've been working on that goal, huh? Talking about getting promoted. I haven't seen you get promoted yet. You see, people can kill your dreams if you let them. Don't let that happen. But with the Chinese bamboo tree, you work on it, you water it, you cultivate it. And then 5 years later, the bamboo shoot will penetrate the ground. Once it penetrates the ground, within 5 weeks, it can grow up to 90 feet. Up to 90 feet. Now here's the question for you. Does the Chinese bamboo tree grow in 5 weeks or 5 years? It's 5 years, folks. So when you make a decision to improve your life, when you make a decision to build the best you, you have to understand it takes time. And don't let people crush your dreams. Stay focused. Cultivate your dreams and nourish your dreams and feed your dreams. And when you don't see the progress, understand that there will be a time that it's going to come. And when it comes, it's going to happen for you, and it's going to happen big time. But you can't give up. You have to stay focused. The last thing that I'm going to leave you with is this. And I do this whenever I speak. Everybody could please stand up for me. You have a great life because you're breathing. And what you choose to do with it up at this point is up to you. You've been given the foundational elements and the 7 steps that'll give you the keys to lock the door, unlock the door to tomorrow, to the happiness, the prosperity, the healthiness that you deserve. And so I want you to say this after me. Today is my day.
Today is my day.
And I will shine.
And I will shine.
I'm Mike Rodriguez. Go forth and have an exceptional life.
I'm Mike Rodriguez.
Don't say that.